Welcome back to the series on key text in humanities and social sciences. Today we are going to do a relevant text by feminist Rosaldo and Louis Lampier. The title of the text under discussion is Women, Culture and Society. Keeping in mind with the idea of doing this series, I'm going to look into this very important feminist anthropologist text from three perspectives of looking into the context of production, context of reception and context of circulation. We try to we'll look into this important text in terms of what this text is trying to tell us, what are the contribution of relevant, and then we're trying to understand what are the main arguments which it led into discussions and debates. So we begin today's discussion on the text by Rosaldo and Louis Lampier called Women, Culture and Society. When we look into this text, we see that this text was first published in 1974 by Stanford University Press. It was a collection of an article, 16 articles, most of them were published by feminists, and 14 of these authors were anthropologists. So the book basically tries to bridge the gap between two different disciplines, that is feminism and anthropology. And when we try to look into the debates of interconnection between feminism and anthropology, let us first try to understand the context of the time on which this text was being written. 1970s reminds us of the second wave of feminism, and we see that at this time most of the text in social sciences, including anthropology, were basically trying to deal with a kind of absence of women, or many scholars have used the term androcentric, that is, they were kind of a neglect of women's perspective, women's role in the society. And in this context, anthropology, beginning from Malinowski to the others, were kind of not at all looking into or reflecting on the context of what women's relevance or women's role in society was. So it was in this context that the text called titled Women, Culture and Society was published. When we look into the title, we see the terms women and culture becomes very significant. So we see that it was for the first time that women's contribution was recognized. We see that it introduces the anthropology of women into mainstream discourse. For the first time, it was being realized that it is very important to bring in on the women's perspective of women's, what is the role of women, what is the position of women in order to understand society. And in that context, this text attempted to recuperate women as distinct cultural actors. Till prior to this, women were seen as dependent on men, or if there was an analysis of men, it was assumed that women were also studied. So therefore, this text brings in women as a cultural actor. As I have already said, that prior to this text, the anthropologists basically were trying to focus on men's life as the universal character of a society. The editor Rosaldo and Lampier stated very clearly in this text that a kind of sexual asymmetry exists between men and women, and this sexual asymmetry is considered to be as universal, that is, it is existence, or it is to be found across all societies. So when we look into the contribution of this text, we first and off try to understand the discipline of feminist anthropology, which is trying to combine two distinct disciplines of feminism and anthropology. Feminist anthropology emerged in 1974-75 with the publication of this relevant text called Women, Culture and Society. They were trying to bring women into the center of analysis, and they were looking into gender at the forefront of ethnographic inquiry. Feminist theories revealed the ways in which women sought and gained power, innovated solutions to oppressive patriarchal societies. So here we was trying to not look into kind of understanding that women's position was to be accepted, but there was a kind of a questioning of the unequal or sexual asymmetry which was considered to be universal. The construct of gender was delineated from sex. So, to bring you back into the concept, we kind of earlier it was considered sex and gender was considered as synonymous. With the publication of this text, gender and sex became to be differentiated in the sense that sex was considered to be biological, and gender was defined as a construct that it is was kind of created and recreated in the everyday relation among men and women, and therefore womenhood was destabilized. So there was something called attribute of being born as a feminine sex leading into kind of femininity was questioned. The field was swept from an empirical focus on women to include gender as a mode of analysis and broadened to include critical perspective on social inequality. So there was a kind of a determinist perspective which assumed social inequality to be natural, or the kind of a phrase in terms of accepting the fact that biology determines our destiny. In very simple words, stated that the fact that women are born as women, they are supposed to have a subordinate status. This was something which the editors and the authors of this text started questioning and re-examining from a different perspective. The feminist perspective demands equality between men and women. So, this was related, the text can also be related in terms of the environment around which was kind of a second wave feminism, which women were demanding kind of a equal status with men and women, not only in terms of everyday relations, but also in the academia, also in terms of disciplinary practices. Anthropologists explain the causes and consequences of inequality and proposes remedy. So, from the fact of taking inequality as natural, as kind of persisting in our society, it was important to actually understand the cause, why it emerges, and at the same time understand how it could be kind of improved, or what could be the remedy for moving towards inequality. The first question arising in the anthropological study of women would be whether these are societies unlike our own, in which women are publicly recognized as equal to more powerful than men. So, the first question that came to the minds of the editors and the author of this book was that it is only in one particular society that we see a difference or inequality between men and women, or is it something that we find it in every society? And therefore, trying to not get any answer to this, they concluded, which I read from the text, all agree that they are society in which women have achieved considerable social recognition and power everywhere. However, that power, they are at the same time excluded from certain crucial economic political activities. Their roles and wives and mothers are associated with fewer power and prerogative than the roles of men. So, if we look into these lines, we see that the clear-cut distinction between the role, the domestic role of the women that is assigned with reproduction and procreation, is completely differentiated from the role of the men, which is considered to be more innovative and more kind of contributing to the constructive part of the society. Feminist anthropologist focuses on three things. Yeah, women's roles and sexual bias. Specifically, they look at what women do in the communities and how did they contribute to the society. So, if we look into the kind of an analysis in anthropology, they were understanding of economy, polity, but prior to the publication of this text, it was assumed that women's was kind of playing no role other than the role assigned to them, which was of reproduction, taking care of children, nurturing them. So, it was very important actually to go back and try to understand, are women doing anything outside the domestic sphere? If yes, what are they trying to actually contribute? So, the second question of a feminist anthropologist is that men are in charge and have power because it's men who are the face of society. To a kind of extent that these discourses, the debates were being kind of discussed and by men who were trying to put across the perspective, which was only looking into the roles and responsibility of men, and therefore the women's kind of became invisible both in academia and society. The private space is a female space, but in the kitchen and in the home, they do wield a lot of power. So this kind of putting it into the dichotomy between the private and the public, and trying to assign women only to the private sphere, and considering that private is inferior or subordinate to public, was assumed that women was not being able to use any kind of power or any kind of authority. But we'll look into, when we go into the chapters of these texts, we see that the authors are questioning this, and there are certain ways in which power is manipulated, and power can be even used in a kind of a domestic private space. One of the most important debate or concept became very debatable on the publication of this text was universal male dominance. They tried to find matriarchal society because they believed that the discovery of this would open up possible of political organization. So what actually was understanding, if we look into anthropology of kinship and understand the way in which anthropology kinship was being discussed, was that we look into the debates of Radcliffe Brown and Evans Pritchard, who were trying to understand society in terms of the principle of descent, where the two kinds of society was differentiated, the patrilineal and the matrilineal society. And the patrilineal society is a society in which the line of descent is through male, and in a matrilineal society the line of descent is female. But what was found out by Audrey Richard is a term called matrilineal puzzle, and that told us that in matrilineal society the line of descent is through female, but power and authority rests in the hand of male, that is mother's brother. So this becomes a very relevant question in terms of trying to understand if there was a kind of a matriarchal society, because a matriarchal means, if we break the term matri plus archal, it would be a society in which power and authority lies in the hands of the women. So this we was trying to figure out, that there was no society in which which was matriarchal in the sense, or rather matriarchal was kind of an illusion, because even in matrilineal society or matrilocal society, power and dominance was in the hands of the men, and therefore the concept of universal male dominance. So when we look into the context of production, we very well understand that this text became very relevant as laying the base or the ground for further analysis of kind of looking into how anthropologists would look into the analysis of women, social inequality, sexual inequality, as well as the roles and responsibilities of women in the society. It also kind of emerged as a critique of the kinship studies, in which most of the studies were being done from the perspective of a male ego. Now, next we go into looking into the content of the text. Now, I'm not going to go into the detailed content, because I already said that it consists of 16 articles, which along with the introduction by Rosaldo and Lampier. What I would expect is that after listening to the debates and discussions here, one would always go back to the book and look into the different content. What is, rather than going into the details of the content, what is important is to understand that this is a text which is covering a wide range of issues, from axiology, psychology, social structure, ecology, economics, politics and power. So in a way, it was like kind of creating an anthropology of women, where women was to be looked into from different perspective, and kind of trying to understand emotions, kind of understanding the family structure, understanding kinship society, understanding neighborhood, understanding the way in which market functions, state functions, and therefore it's a kind of a very vivid description of women's role in society. What is the argument of most of the authors in this text is that women are universally subordinate in all types of society. Biological determinism is set aside, and social cultural reaction to sexual dimorphism is established. So, as I already said, that there was a kind of a biological determinist where we accept sexuality or sex as biology, or even the fact of being a woman as biological and natural. That was kind of rejected, and a new kind of a perspective was being built in which the status of women was kind to be understood with reference to the cultural setting, and therefore the title of the book, Women, Culture and Society. When we look into in terms of its contribution to anthropology, in the course of the discussion, I will discuss the how it emerged kind of understanding of a dichotomy of an for the analysis of gender cross culturally, dichotomies like private public, domestic versus the public, again reproduction versus production. A whole set of dichotomies were seen becoming very relevant to understand women's status in society, and this is one of the texts in which the dichotomy of domestic public, nature, culture has been debated and negated by the authors. The second contribution to anthropology is in terms of an intervention in the positive agenda of cognitive and psychological anthropology. So, it's not only looking into the social structure, which is also trying to, authors are going to debate how it is a kind of inequality or the social inequality related to the position of men and women, also in terms of the psychological well-being or in terms of the way women feel and think, or the emotional emotions of women and men, and that will help us to kind of contribute not only to anthropology but also to psychological understanding of society. The third contribution is that the attention to social base of emotions and feeling, and that is very significant as a kind of a feminist contribution in terms of anthropology, not only being trying to understand the economy and political state and society, but at the same time the emotions and feelings of actors and agents becomes very significant in order to understand social relations. And this is something again which is being contributed through the different articles which are part of this text. Now, I go into the some of the important debates or discourse which emerged from the this text, and one of the important, as I already said, is the domestic public dichotomy. Michel Rosaldo proposed a dichotomy between a domestic orientation in women and a public orientation in men as theoretical framework to analyze the universal position of women. So, let try to understand, which I have already said, that these are two domain which was being put into. One is a domestic, which is within the four walls of the household, where women are assigned the job of procreation, nurturing and reproductive work. This is opposed to the public dichotomy, which is in terms of outside the house, which is the kind of a place where people from different class, different background are participating in economic political activity, and it was a line that it was a domain which was dominated by men. And this dichotomy between the domestic and the public became one of the crucial idea to understand the universal subordination of women. Domestic meant that those minimal institutions and modes of activity that are organized immediately around one or more mothers and their children. Public referred to activities, institutions and forms of association that link, rank, organize or subsume particular mother-child group. So, the kind of a understanding of role assignment in terms of the natural inclination became significant. It was believed or it was argued that women, since they are into kind of engaged in reproductive activity in terms of child care, nurturing, they would be more comfortable in the domestic sphere, and since the major part of their life they are engaged in these domestic sphere, they would be excluded from the public domain. Women are primarily involved in domestic relations and activities, while men are free to from broader association in the public domain. Women are bound to enduring time-consuming and emotionally compelling commitment as exemplified in a mother's relation with her infant child. Whereas men can keep their distance from domestic life and engage themselves in the hierarchical political work. When we look into the role assignment of the women and men in terms of the public domestic public dichotomy, we see that it kind of presumes, or it kind of, there is an inbuilt inequality or inferior superior relation within it. It argued that since domestic was a realm of reproduction, nurturing and caring, it was kind of a more emotional field. It was kind of a more kind of emotions required, and women were more emotional and therefore they could take care of the child, whereas the men, the work which is in the public domain entails political economic activity, and these are considered as being more significant for the society, and therefore they were ranked in a higher position. So the ranking of domestic and public led into a kind of subordinate and superior relation between men and women. Women who were doing domestic work were considered as subordinate, and men were considered as kind of superior. And this kind explains the universal subordination of women. The second important concept, which I have repeatedly said, is the sexual asymmetry. Recognizes that men's and women's fears are typically distinguished. These essay examines the evidence for asymmetrical valuation of the sexes across a range of culture and asks how these valuation can be explained. So, it is asymmetry is universal, it is found in all society, but the meaning attached to this or the values attached to it would differ from culture to culture. And when we read this text, we see it is a collection of fieldwork ethnographic study from different parts of the society, and it tries to explain a kind of an understanding of why the valuation assigned to women's work and men's work is culturally different but universally recognizes subordinate status of women. The recognition of a sexual asymmetry raised the subject of male domination and female subordination and how the position of women was to be explained. They eliminate the strategies by which women in different cultures achieve a surprising degree of political power and social recognition, and investigate from case oriented and comparative perspective the social structure, legal, psychological, economic, ritual, mythological and metaphorical factor that account for variation in women life. So, if we look into it, there are different explanation from different fields coming in, but these whether we look into the legal structure or we look into the psychological economic structure, what is common among all is the whole understanding that asymmetry is kind of universally present in all cultures. Authors puts forth the controversial position that no matter how much de facto power and influence women may have in any society, including for example major roles in productions, they are never given public valued power, that is authority. So, here the way in which Weber explains the power and authority has been used, and authority is the legitimate use of power. So, though kind of there is a lot of explanation which would say that in a kind of sexual relation or the sexual asymmetry in family is kind of based on not only gender relation but also in age factor, and there are scholars who argue that as women move ahead from one role to the other, that is from say from a daughter-in-law to a mother-in-law and to a grandmother, the kind of power and authority that she assumes becomes kind of different. But then it is kind of not a formalized authority. It is only kind of something which is accepted and which is part of kind of again the domestic sphere. When it comes into the public realm, the authority wielded by women becomes questionable. All contemporary societies are to some extent male dominated, although the degree and expression of female subordination vary greatly. Sexual asymmetry is present as a universal fact of human social life. So, the degree in which the asymmetry exists, it could be different from some say, and that is kind of an again going back to the example of a matrilineal society. the degree of asymmetry would be different from what would be there in a matrilineal society, but it is not denied that even in a matrilineal society, sexual asymmetry is exists. By showing that women like men are social actors seeking power, security, prestige and a sense of worth and value, these papers from the book demonstrate that inadequacy of conventionally male-oriented accounts of social structure, something which I have already discussed, that the text was basically kind of an reaction to the male-oriented discussions and debates in anthropology, and it's also kind of related to the emergence of a second wave feminism, where the idea was to kind of integrate deeper into understanding social inequality and the ranking and stratification in society. The result was that men are seen to have a monopoly of authority, women's power, while considerable in some societies, are never legitimate. Rosaldo puts forth the controversial position that no matter how much de facto power and influence women may have in any society, including major roles in productions, they never gain public authority. Now, we will go into not all the 16 articles in these books, but few of them, which some of the text I will discuss in detail and others I will discuss briefly. So, we go to the first discussion by Nancy Chodoro, which is a psychoanalysis understanding of emotions and feelings and helps us to understand gender subordination. Nancy Chodoro was a feminist theorist who brought together academic fields of sociology, anthropology and psychoanalysis in her related to feminist theory and understanding of gendered relations in the family. She holds that gender is a matter of having feminine and masculine personality that develops in early infants as response to prevalent parenting practice. So, it's a kind of influenced by Sigmund Freud understanding that the development of a feminine identity or a masculine identity in a individual is to a large extent dependent on the socialization, and there are lot of kind of examples given in gender socialization that we come across in terms of kind of a young girl who is kind of plays with dolls and kitchen sets and always tries to put on the makeover of her mother. And in opposition to this, a young boy would also always try to wear the shoes of his father, pick up his bag and try to act as going to the office. From this role playing, we see that the child is learning feminine and masculine identity, and that also in terms of there's a lot of discussions which also tells us in terms of how parents kind of socialize children, and they kind of make a distinction between boys and girls, where boys are kind of trained to become strong and become kind of responsible, where young girls are kind of socialized to be very sentimental, very soft and caretaking kind. So, these attributes have been very beautifully brought into Nancy Chodoro's article, where she tries to explain gender identity from a psychoanalysis perspective. Care, development and socialization of children and female is largely rested upon women. So, this follows the kind of public-private dichotomy, and the women are assigned the domestic domain in which they are responsible for care, development and socialization of children. The mother-daughter relationship differs from the mother-son relations because mothers are more likely to identify with daughters than their son. So, the kind of emotions and feelings and attachment which goes into the development of a feminine and a masculine identity. Chodoro thinks that these gender differences should and can be changed. Feminine and masculine personality play a crucial role in women's oppression, since they make female overtly attentive to the needs of others and males emotionally deficient. in order to correct the situation, both male and female parents would be equally involved in parenting. So when we look into Nancy Chorodo's article, we try to understand, one, that kind of a gender socialization based on stereotypes of femininity and masculinity leads into kind of a perpetuation of the gender inequality. The second is that since most of the time it is the women who is given the task of socialization and bringing up children, the kind of persistence of gender norms becomes significant. And therefore, you know, many a time nowadays we see that if an individual is not able to go by what is considered as norms of femininity and masculinity, then they kind of face the problem of gender identity. So to avoid this, it is very significant that both the parents are kind of equally involved and kind of not go so much by the distinction between feminine and masculine, but in terms of kind of developing a personality. The second essay in this text is by Sherry Ottner, and this article is to nature and kind of brings in a second kind of a dichotomy, which is this nature and culture. Sherry Ottner argued that in society, women are considered as related to nature and men are considered as related to culture. So this again comes in from the same dichotomy between domestic and public, that is, the domestic was considered to be a realm of reproduction. And therefore, since they are into the act of reproduction and procreation, they are considered to be aligned with nature. Because nature is also kind of based on multiplicity and fertility. Men are not outside the realm of nature, and therefore they are considered to be very close to culture because they are engaged in technological innovation. So because of women's painful bodily physical experience, reproductive power and nurturing nature, they are treated as near to culture. She comments that women are naturally productive because they have the capacity to carry baby. So basically, Sherry Ottner questions the nature culture assumption and kind of through her argument would try to show that even though the women are kind of engaged in reproductive kind of an activity, it is the meaning that we are going to attach it, and if we change the perspective in which we look into reproduction or the task of kind of physical task work that she is doing, and then it could be understood as completely kind of doing something which is put into a productive work. So the distinction between the reproductive and productive is kind of again erroneous, or it is based on certain kind of an assumption. Men do not have this natural productivity, so that is saying that there is something which the men are lacking, and therefore the hierarchy of women being subordinate should be questioned. That is why they try to take part in artificial productivity. They put their efforts in the public spheres and create artificially. So are they treated as closer to culture? The task of culture is to mold the nature. As culture gets more importance in comparison to nature, men also gets more importance in the society. Nancy Chodoro and Ottner concluded that male dominance is universal. So when we try to look into Nancy Chodoro's essay or Rosaldo, Ottner's essay, what is common in both is the fact that dominance is kind of universal, with Rosaldo attributing it to the division of labor and distribution of authority across a violently enforced private-public divide. Chorodo locating women's exclusion from the public in their maternal functions and the socialization of girls. So, if we go into looking into the kind of analysis, they are basically questioning some of the assumptions also on which the entire institution of family is functioning. The third essay in this book is by Frederick Angel, and Frederick Angel is actually trying to argue that not all societies are dominated by men, and that egalitarianism prevails in those private property, and the particular construction of women as private property has not yet developed. His text, The Emergence of Family and Private Property, basically looks into kind of an evolution of society from a matrilineal society to a patriarchal society on the issue of the change in the relations of productions. So he argues that once the society was kind of collective or communal productive activity took place. The society was a matrilineal society. There was the absence of family and marriage as an institution. But as slowly and slow, as men started acquiring private property, they needed individuals to take care of the stocks and animals and the piece of land, and therefore they started domesticating women. So Frederick Angel basically says that as men domesticated animals, they also started domesticating women, and therefore the gender domestic violence or gender based violence can is also understood from this. So the argument is that male dominance is a function of history. So it was not always that the society was unequal or social inequality was a part of something which was a part of every society, and therefore Frederick Angel says that it is a function of history. As societal transformation takes place, private property emerges, gender's relations becomes more unequal or egalitarian. He argues that the situation of women is getting worse and worse in the course of social evolution. Frederick Angel argues that the universal asymmetry was not timeless, but a product of capitalist relations that came to dominate the global mode of production through colonialism. Following Frederick Angel, there are a large number of feminist scholars who say who would argue that feminism and patriarchy, they functions in the same direction. And to further this argument, they say that as capitalism appropriates the surplus value of the working class or the property less, patriarchy appropriates the power of the productive power of the women. So basically, they are both capitalism and patriarchy results in a kind of asymmetrical relation. In capitalism, there is an asymmetrical relation between the working class and the capitalist. In patriarchy, there is an asymmetrical relation men and women. And therefore, in terms of the analysis which the text Women, Culture and Society has influenced a large number of individuals. And there are scholars who argue that in order, just as Karl Marx suggested that kind of a class revolution which would actually do away with class inequality, feminists suggest that in order to kind of do away with sexual asymmetry or gender inequality, we need to do away with the kind of a patriarchal structure that we have in society. Further, Frederick Angel says that women's handicap stems from evolution of society, and discrimination is connected with the development of private property, patriarchal family, and then individual one, as well as social classes. This is caused mainly by isolation from public sphere, production sphere in particular, economic dependence on men, housework and child care. So that is the kind in which the society is moving in terms of economic transformation should be kind of beneficial and kind of be equally accessible to men and women. But when we look into Frederick Angel's analysis, we understand that rather than moving towards an egalitarian society, society has become kind of more, the gender gap has become even wider. The fourth article in this text is by Carol Stack. Carol Stack developed a women-based theory of family structure and kinship in an African-American community to write against the culture of poverty and ideology. So we see we are moving from domestic public debate to nature culture debate to looking into private property, and now we look into a kind of racist kind of understand gender and race, where we look into the African black community and also look into the ideology which kind of a Western lens help us to look into society which are poor, which are society which are kind of lower in the hierarchy, are seen as kind of disorganized, as kind of unstable. But the Carol Stark questions this kind of assumptions. She describes the kinship network through which family members exchange essential goods, service and cash that allow them to survive in a community characterized by chronic unemployment and irregular employment. If we look into Carol Stack's contribution, we see the text is basically questioning some of the very legitimate kind of assumption according to which society was functioning. The next essay in this text is by Nancy Tanner. Nancy Tanner shows three Indonesian societies in which culturally defined role of mother is met central societies. This is not always a genealogical mother, but sometimes the senior women is a kinship unit. So that is that again questions the Radcliffe Brown understanding of descent, where genealogy were very significant in understanding kinship, and we move to a kind of concept of relatedness, which says that it is not necessary to be related by blood or marriage. There could be kind of a relations in which through. So here the senior most women is treated symbolically as a mother. Relationship between women and men are relatively egalitarian, and there is a minimum of differentiation between genders. Tanner notes that in Java there is little difference between women and men with regard to initiative, assertiveness, autonomy and decisiveness. Overall, women in matrifocal societies find their identity not as appendages to husband or brothers, but rather as relatively independent and active women and mothers. So this changes the notion of how we see women in a large number of society through works which try to look into women as dependent members on brothers and sisters, a kind of understanding where women was needed a protector, women's income was considered as secondary, or the idea of men as primary breadwinners. So all these notions are not necessarily culturally universal. So they are kind of a difference in which these ideas are prevalent or accepted by society. Tanner notes that the image of the strong, active mother with which black women are more identified than middle class white women has made middle class black women less ambivalent than their white counterpart about combining careers with marriage. So we kind of also bring in understanding race and class negotiation in terms of employment, and also balancing work and office by the different class of women. So there is a kind of interconnection, or kind of a holistic understand of looking into gender, class and race. The image of black mothering is the most accessible image middle class white women have that can counter the tendency to assimilate mother to wife, that is counter and sidekick status that attaches to wife. So this is Oakley trying to understand the entire reimagining of the general accepted understanding of the image of mother, which is being questioned through Nancy Tanner's understanding of African black community. The next essay in this text is O Laughlin. O Laughlin combines Marxism and symbolism to explain universal subordination of women. So she studies the Maboon women who are seen as structurally parallel to chicken. This is a society in which there is a taboo on women to consume chicken, and the author is trying to explain why there is a kind of taboo, and this taboo actually symbolically explains the subordinate status of women. And the explanation is that both women and chicken are kept for reproduction rather than production. So the role of the two is in kind of a reproductive role, and therefore they are not used in productive activity, and therefore the chickens are not to be eaten but are to be have to be bred. Hence, the taboo on women not to eat chicken symbolically explains their subordinate status. The product of women's labor and reproductions are alienated from them by men who control the distribution of surplus and bride wealth. So you see that these women's task is kind of only in the reproductive sphere. They don't get involved in productive, which is defined as a kind of a public domain. Even the product of their reproductive labor are kind of controlled by the men. The contradiction of women's reproductive power being alienated from them is only seemingly mediated by the taboo on eating chicken. So this is kind of an understanding of a kind of a practice which will explain symbolically the structures of the society. Now, there's no, because of the shortage of time, we cannot go into all the 16 essays of the book. So now I will briefly look into the other studies. The other articles provide data that challenge or contradict the model of female subordination as constructed by Rosaldo, Ottner, and Chodoro. So the kind of the text, the book Women, Culture, and Society can be divided into two parts. On in the first part, the authors are kind of constructing the idea of a universal male subordination, and in the second part, the kind of challenges because they are, it is based on different cultures, so not all culture would support the whole idea of a universal female subordination. What would differ is kind of a degree of subordination. First, given that in most societies women's status is subordinate to men in the public sphere, Sandeep, her article is Female Status in the Public Domain, tries to find out the conditions in which women's status would be equal to men. So she's trying to actually try to figure out that is it a reality that universal status is a reality of every society. Her findings reveal that when women contribution in the production is equal to men, then the public status tends to be equal. So here, if kind of a study from the class factor, we see the lower class women are taking participating in the productive sphere, and therefore their status are comparatively egalitarian from the upper class, where we see the women's withdraw from the market. So the participation of women in the upper class is less, and therefore the relation between men and women are more unequal. Likewise, Hoffe, whose article is Madame Yoko, Ruler of the Kappa Mende Confederacy. In this article, the author shows that at least elite women can achieve the same level of public authority and elite that elite men can. So she brings in the concept of class, that there are certain category of women belonging to a certain class who have the same status as their counterpart. So Madame Yoko managed to create a large confederacy than her predecessor husband. She did this by using power accessible only to women, making alliance via female members of the society for whom she arranged both initiation and marriage, making them doubly dependent on her. She means power are not open to all women. However, being open to some demonstrates that women is not homogeneous category, but different women have different access to power. Two things becomes relevant from this essay. One, that it is, even if we accept the fact that women are kind of engaged in reproductive procreation and the area of kinship is closer to women, it is not necessarily to perceive it as into kind of a negative term. It can be beneficial for women because using that sphere of domesticity and kinship network, women can wield power. Number two is to try to understand the whole notion that women are not a homogeneous category. The kind of intersections on caste, class, race becomes very crucial to understand their status across societies. Another approach is to see that there may be an ideology of male dominance, but women may be seen as political actors maneuvering against their own subordination. That is, they kind of legitimately it is accepted of male dominance, but in the everyday interaction, women can actually manipulate or women can kind of inverse this male dominance and use it for their advantage. Collier's article Women in Politics shows that in patrilineal patrilocal society, supposedly powerless and apolitical women may manipulate their male king to further their own ends. So the patrilineal patrilocal society, there is a very clear understanding that the women are kind of subordinate, they are helpless, they are powerless. But the whole idea kind of women negotiating their position in everyday society depends on kind of individual context in which one is placed. The next essay is Denik, Sex and Power in the Balkans. He proposes that this situation of women paradoxically holding significant source of power in matrilineal society have ideology of women helplessness can be termed as patrilineal paradox. So, just in the beginning when I use the term matrilineal puzzle, we can also have a similar concept in a patrilineal society, the is kind of a patrilineal paradox. The patrilineal paradox is very clear. It states that in a patrilineal society, women can also kind of wield power and authority irrespective of the fact that they are not in the line of descent through the concept of lineage and descent. They don't behold property and authority, but through negotiation, they are able to wield this. Rosaldo's idea that women's status is highest where there is least domestic public dichotomy is elaborated by Sack. So, when Rosaldo was explaining the domestic public dichotomy, it was said that if the domestic public dichotomy is reduced, then the kind of status of women could improve. This idea was further developed by Sack. In her article Angel Revisited, Women and the Organization of Production and Private Property, she modifies Angel's idea that the oppression of women originates with the development of private property. She suggests that whenever there is the least distinction between the domestic and the public domain, women's status will be high. So, the kind of Rosaldo was kind of a building inverse relation. Sack is kind of arguing that we need to kind of do away with the public domestic and public dichotomy in order to kind of do away with gender inequality. Now, when we look into these number of essays, we will kind of see that it has obviously kind of been systematic to the development of gender as a category in understanding, and it was kind of critiqued, the dichotomy was critiqued, and it was replaced by a sex gender system. One of the most lucid and sustained theoretical critique to emerge from Rosaldo and Lampier's work was Gail Rubin under the title The Traffic in Women, Notes Towards a Political Economy of Sex. Here, Rubin is actually giving us the concept of sex gender system in which the dichotomy is kind of replaced by with a continuum. And it is kind of understanding that earlier the sex was biological, gender was kind of a social construct. Gail Rubin's articulation will try to make us see both sex and gender as a kind of social construct in terms of the meaning that individual attached to both. So, sex gender was used to describe the set of arrangement by which a society transforms biologically social sexuality into the products of human activity. Rubin proposed that the links between biological sex, social gender and sexual attractions are both products of culture. So, we not only look into gender as kind of a culturally significant concept, it also try to understand the concepts which kind of links to the development of gender. Gender is thus a social product that we attach to notions of biological sex. So, we need to delimit this kind of an understanding and try to understand sex as well as a social construct. Post publication of the book, critique of male ethnographers' description as one-sided and an ad women and mixed approach to ethnography became popular, whereby women were not necessarily described in details but mentioned as part of the wider culture. So, this is kind of a drawback or limitation of the text, because as I already began that this text introduced the anthropology of women. It was the first time that scholars and authors started looking into the category of women as relevant in anthropology. What was the consequence was that the women category of women became kind of something which is in fashion, and people did not enter into deep analysis but use the tag of women just to ensure that it was kind of contributing to gender study. Gail Rubin's work transformed anthropology of women into anthropology of gender. So, in order to do away with this defect of kind of women being used as an add-on, it was important to shift the attention from women to gender, and that was kind of the feminists are not only kind of trying to understand the role and position of women, but they are trying to understand gender inequality, and therefore this marked a critical shift in the anthropology or feminist anthropology. This shift to gender as an analytical category reflected that the concern with female lives could not just be about women, but about relations, practice and politics in which gendered identity were construed and socially and culturally mediated. So, when we look into the whole kind of analysis right from the first essay to the last essay, it will help us to understand that the text by Rosaldo and Lampier is significant in understanding discourse on sexuality, gender, and also kind of understanding shift from women to gender and making gender as an important category in analysis and understanding economy, polity and society. With this, I come to an end to today's lecture. Thank you.